Hello all. In this lecture, we will learn about the genetic algorithms, which is another widely used metaheuristic algorithm and which has a different structure than the local search-based algorithms like TabuSearch and simulated annealing. So before starting with the genetic algorithms, we will see a summary of local search-based metaheuristic algorithms. We will see their main advantages and disadvantages, and then we will start learning the genetic algorithms. We will learn their general structure. We will learn how to encode the solutions. We will learn the crossover and mutation operators in genetic algorithms, which are the main factors or main functions of genetic algorithms to provide new solutions, and we will make some examples to learn the algorithm better. So let's start with the local search-based metaheuristics. In these algorithms, the main goal is to avoid getting stuck in local optima. In local search algorithms, we said that the algorithm stops whenever a local optima is encountered. But this local optima can be far away from the global optima. Therefore, in metaheuristic algorithms, by allowing non-improving moves or with different mechanisms, we try to avoid getting stuck in local optima. In order to this main goal, we have some additional goals, which are exploring a larger part of the search space. Okay, we want to explore the large part of the search space in order to find better solutions. And we want to find the global optima, not just the local optima. Okay, and we want these metaheuristic algorithms to be a reasonable alternative for exact methods, because exact methods, especially for large and hard problem instances, require a lot of computational time. Okay, so the use of any kind of heuristic algorithm is usually to reduce this computational time without sacrificing much from the solution quality. Okay, we want to find high quality solutions, if not exact, still very closer to exact solutions, in reasonable amount of time. This statement is very important. Reasonable amount of time statement is very important because we need to make a differentiation between the problems. There are some operational problems which you need to solve maybe within seconds. So currently, for example, if you develop a learning type artificial intelligence method for an autonomous robot, then this robot should make decisions within maybe milliseconds. Then your algorithm should work and find the solution in seconds or milliseconds. But for example, if you are solving a long-term planning problem, strategic planning problem, for example, a facility location problem, then usually you don't need to solve it in seconds. Maybe you can solve it in hours or days because it is not a quick decision. So therefore, when we say reasonable amount of time for an operational problem, this reasonable time is very short. You need to come up with a solution very quickly. But for strategic planning problems, you may solve the problem in days. And if you can find the exact optimum solution within that allocated time, then you can just use those exact algorithms. You don't need a heuristic. But still, if the exact algorithm cannot find the optimal solution within days, in that case, still you may need a heuristic algorithm. So we are not just going directly to heuristic algorithms. We first need to understand if we need a heuristic or not, and what is the necessary time or given time to solve those problems. So what is the time that we have in our hand to solve those problems? Different methods Different meta-heuristic algorithms have different techniques to escape from local optima. So until now we learned simulated annealing and taboo search algorithms. Simulated annealing relies on randomness. Okay, we select a neighbor randomly. If this neighbor is an improving one, we directly accept it. But if it is not an improving one, if it is a worsening one, if it is a non-improving move, then still we can select it. But in order to accept or reject this solution, we use a probability and we use randomness. Okay? So simulated annealing relies on this controlled random movement. But on the other hand, taboo search relies on memory structures. We said that this memory property of the taboo search algorithm is the most distinctive feature of taboo search. What we are doing, we are allowing non-improving moves in taboo search to escape from local optima, but in order to prevent this cycling, the looping behavior, we forbid some of the moves for a temporary number of iterations, temporarily. After that, we again set them free so that we can search different parts of the feasible region without cycling through the same set of solutions. If we compare the simulated annealing and taboo search algorithms, what can we say? Which method is better? We cannot directly say that one of them is better than the other one. It all depends on your needs. And also, in different problems, they may perform differently. Also, the case is this. Each of these meta-heuristic algorithms have their own parameters. And you need to find the optimal settings for those parameters. If you have a simulated annealing for which the parameters such as the cooling initial temperature, the neighborhood structure, the cooling schedule, if these are not optimized, then that simulated annealing algorithm may perform poor. But you cannot say that simulated annealing is poor, performs worse than the taboo search algorithm. When you optimize those parameters, simulated annealing may perform better than taboo search. So when we are comparing simulated annealing and taboo search, let's think that we optimize their parameters. Okay, for both of them, let's assume that we have the optimal parameter values. Then what are the basic advantages of these? Usually, simulated annealing is easier to implement. So when we develop these algorithms, you need to implement these in computer programs, Java, C++, Python. Okay, so writing the code of simulated annealing is easier. So this is one important advantage of simulated annealing. Also, understanding the simulated annealing and how it functions is easier. So this is another advantage. But of course, these depend from situation to situation. Usually, taboo search algorithm is more flexible and robust. It requires better understanding of the problem. So in order to develop a taboo search algorithm, you need to forbid some of the moves. So how will you record those moves in your taboo list? You need to know the structure of the problem much better. So understand the problem well, so that you can forbid those moves in an appropriate way, and you can prevent cycling, and you can facilitate diversification. Taboo search requires more tuning. When we say tuning the parameters, because taboo search algorithm has more parameters. You need to decide on the initial solution. You need to decide on the length of the taboo list, and you need to decide on how will you record these moves in the taboo list. You need to set the aspiration criteria. You need to define the neighborhood. You need to define the stopping criteria. Some of them are common with simulated annealing, but some of them are specific to tabu search. And usually for tabu search, you need to make more tuning on the decisions of these parameters. But usually tabu search produces better overall results, but this is just a generalization, and it may not be true all the time. It depends on the problem, it depends on the implementation, it depends on the instance. Okay, sometimes simulated annealing may perform better than tabu search. But the thing is, simulated annealing, since simulated annealing relies on randomness, in this sense, tabu search is a more guided way of finding the solution. Okay, so this is one of the advantages of tabu search over simulated annealing. After remembering these local search-based meta-heuristic algorithms, now we can learn another idea for a meta-heuristic, which is not local search-based algorithm. So genetic algorithms is a directed search algorithm based on the mechanics of biological evolution. So during this course, we will be talking about crossovers, mutations, population generation, genes, and survival of the fittest. All these terms are coming from biology. What are the components of a genetic algorithm? Of course, you need a problem, and you need an encoding technique. How do you encode the solutions? We will talk about these. And this encoding is called genes or chromosomes in genetic algorithms. How do you initialize the procedure? And this will be called creation. How will you evaluate the objective function? So it is the environment, because it gives you the fitness, its name is called fitness function, and it will show you how you are fit to the environment. So we will talk about selection of parents for reproduction. We will talk about genetic operators such as mutation, crossover, recombination, and the parameter settings. There are many parameters of genetic algorithms, and the setting the optimal values for this parameter is both a practice and an art. So, until now, in the algorithms that we have seen, in tabu search, in simulated annealing, we started from a solution. We evaluated the neighbors of this solution. We selected one of them, and we jumped to this solution. Then we evaluated the neighbors of this one, and we jumped to another one. And then evaluated the neighbors of this solution and went to another one. So at each step of these algorithms, we always had one current solution. Okay, one current solution. But if you look at in the real life, as human beings we are, or all the animals, living in populations, in groups. Okay, so in genetic algorithms, instead of having a single solution, we have a number of solutions. Okay, not just a single solution, but a number of solutions. So these solutions will be named as individuals. Okay, and the set of all individuals will be named as population. Okay, so what happens in real life? We have this population at an instant of time, but as the time passes, what happens? Some of these individuals die, some of them get married and have children, and etc. So after some time, what happens? We have, when we look at this population again, we see that the population evolves, turns into another set of solutions. So this, the previous one, this is called generation. Let's say if it is the starting generation, it is generation zero. Then from generation 0, we move to generation 1. And again, still in this generation, we have individuals and we have a population of these individuals. Okay. And then from this generation, we move to another generation after when we look at the same population after a certain amount of time. So this becomes generation 2 and etc. And this is the evolve or improvement of the solution in genetic algorithms. But what you should understand is in taboo search and simulated annealing, we always have one current solution in our hand, and from that one current solution, we generate or we move to another current solution. But in genetic algorithms, we have a population of solutions, and from this population of solutions, we move to another population of solutions, and then from this one to another population of solutions, and each of these are named as generations. Okay, so let's assume that we have generation X. From this generation X, while evolving to generation X plus 1, the next generation, what happens? So in this generation, we have a population of 10 individuals. Okay, so in genetic algorithms, the size of the population is kept as identical. From one generation to another, the population size does not change. It is always 10. So the method of forming new solutions in genetic algorithms is one important method is to make crossovers. And basically, in crossovers, we select a pair of individuals and we pair them. And using their individual genes, we form offsprings or children. Okay, so we apply this procedure to several individuals in the population to generate a number of new solutions. We will talk about how to make these crossovers. Another method to provide some diversity in the population and generate new solutions is to use mutation. And in mutation, basically, individual genes of the individuals in the population are subject to random changes. Okay, so usually this mutation is a smaller probability. If you look at the real life, the mutation appears in very small with very small probabilities, but when it appears, it may affect the solution space, and it may provide very good solutions, very good characteristics into the population. And when we have our previous population, the newly generated solutions through crossover and mutation, then for the next generation, we need to select 10 of them, because 10 is the number of population, individuals in the population. We need to select some of them so that we remain the number. So a number of solutions are directly moved from one generation to another. So these light blue ones, you see, directly moved to the next generation. And these are called elite solutions. They are elite because their fitness value, their objective function value are better than the others. Therefore, we say that, okay, a percentage of the best solutions in this population will directly go to the next generation. Okay, by this way, we maintain the good solutions in the population. And then, since this is a percentage, let's say that this is 10, and we say that 70% of the individuals will come directly from the previous generation. So we have 7 solutions from this previous generation. Then we say that, okay, 20% of the solutions will come from crossover, okay, and then 10% of the solutions will have a mutation. So in this way we maintain the number of 10 individuals in the population. Okay, so the method of moving from one generation to another is to move some of the solutions directly, which are called elite solutions, and we select these solutions with respect to their fitness value. Basically, fitness value is usually the objective function value. Some of them comes from crossover operation and some of them comes from mutation, so that from this generation X we move to generation X plus 1. And then when we are moving from generation X plus 1 to X plus 2, again we have a number of elite solutions, a number of solutions with which we generated by crossover, and a number of solutions which are generated by mutation operation. Okay. So this is the basic mechanism of the genetic algorithms. Of course, you need to know many details about this procedure, but this is the general idea. Of course, we need to know how we perform these crossover operations, how we perform mutation, and how to decide on the elite solutions, how to decide on the number of individuals in the population. So there are many factors that we need to know and that we need to decide on. So usually the stopping criteria for genetic algorithms is to have n generations. So you start with generation 0, then from this one you move to 1, to 2, and etc. And when you reach to the nth generation, then you stop the algorithm. And when you stop the algorithm, you have a population of individuals. Since from moving one generation to another, we always keep the best individuals, a percentage of best individuals, it means that the best solution is always in our population. So when we stop the algorithm, the best solution in this population is the solution that is provided by genetic algorithms. For every step in the evolution process, we need to select the individuals for these genetic operations. We need to create new individuals, which is called reproduction. So how do we select individuals from a population to become parents? How do we perform this crossover operation? How do we perform with these mutation operations, and how do we select the elite solutions or the solutions that will be survived in the next generation? Okay, we decide all these and we maintain the fixed population size at each generation. So in generation 0, we start with m individuals. And we make all those operations, crossover, mutation, and etc. In generation 1, we have M. Generation 2, we have M. And in generation N, we have M. But be careful. These are not strict rules. These are usually how this genetic algorithm is adapted. But if you want to design your own genetic algorithm, and if you want to increase and reduce the size of the population with respect to some criteria, and if it provides better solutions, then you can do. There is no strict rule on these. They are all design criteria. It is important to know how we represent the solutions in genetic algorithms, because it affects how you perform your crossover operations, how you perform your mutation operations. Depending on the representation of the solutions, you may have different operations. In classical genetic algorithms, if you are solving a problem, with binary decision variables, which can only take 0 or 1 values, like the knapsack problem, usually we use such an encoding. This is called solution encoding. Okay? And let's assume that we have 7 decision variables. So these numbers here represent the decision variables. So this one over here represents the value of the first decision variable. This is the value of the second decision variable. This is what we did in TabuSearch and simulated annealing also. But in genetic algorithms, these have special names. So this representation is called a chromosome. Okay, so a full solution of decision variables is named a chromosome. Sometimes they are called as component vectors, vectors, string, solution, individual. These are the same name to represent the solutions. Okay, so this is how we represent. But the thing is, this is for a binary problem. When we have TSP in which the decision variable is xij, you cannot just represent it with a single vector of solutions. Okay? Maybe you will have a matrix of solutions. Or what you can do, you can take this row, the second row of this table, and attach it to this here, and you will have a very, very long string chromosome. And at each chromosome, you see only one value will be one here, all of them, all others will be zero, and etc. So maybe in some cases, representing the solution in this way is not the best way. So for TSP, again, as we did in NAPSEC or TabuSearch algorithms, we can represent a solution by the sequence, by the order of cities. So 1, 2, 3, 5, 4, 6, for example. This can be a representation of a solution for TSP. So now this becomes my chromosome. Okay? So we may have different representations with respect to different problems, in different problems. Each individual value of a variable is named as a gene, and sometimes they are called also as component or variable. Okay? So here, this gene is the gene of the third variable. And in this representation, these are the genes, individual genes. In real life, in biology, these genes gives your physical characteristics. And you should encode the solution in genetic algorithms in this way so that these genes should give some characteristics to the solutions, so that when you keep a gene from one generation to another, the same characteristic should be maintained. Okay? So it's important to think about this, the solution encoding and the combination of this encoding with crossover and mutation operations is very important because of that. So here, the position index here is called the locus. Okay, so this is the third position. It is called either locus or position. And the value of the decision variable is sometimes named as allele or value. Okay. And here, for example, this x3, the value of x3 can be 0 or 1. And this is the domain. Okay, this x3 can only assume values either 0 or 1. So these alleles can be 0 or 1. This is how we can encode a solution for a NAPSEC type problem, binary problems with single dimensions. Crossover is maybe the most important operator in genetic algorithms to form new solutions. Now here we will see the classical crossover, but there may be many different types of crossovers. As the developer of a genetic algorithm for a new problem, you may define your own crossover operator, and these crossover operators are limited by your imagination. Okay? You can create, you can define many different types of crossover operators. So in the classical crossover operator, how it is used, the most widely used method is this one. one parent is selected based on its fitness value. Okay, so if the fitness value is larger, it has a larger probability of selection. The other parent is selected randomly. So sometimes both parents are selected randomly, but this randomness depends on the parent, so which is called tournament selection procedure, or roulette wheel selection. Wheel selection procedure. So what do you do? For example, in order to select parents, let's assume that you have a population, you have individuals over here. Let's say that we are making a maximization, and for this maximization, let's assume that this has a fitness value of 100. This individual has a fitness value of 80. This individual has a fitness value of 75. This has a fitness value of 250, and etc. Okay, so for a maximization problem, this individual is a better one, this individual is the second one, and this individual is a poor one. So in order to select these individuals to pair and to provide offsprings, to generate offsprings, we use the same idea as generating these random numbers. So what do we do? Okay, this becomes our, let's say, whole solution space, which is the summation of fitness values of all individuals. Okay. Then from 0 to, let's say, 250, we say that, okay, this is, let's say, individual 1, this is individual 2, this is 3, this is 4. So we say that this region is for individual 1. Then from 250 to 350, this is individual 2, because this area is equal to the fitness value of individual 2. Then from 350 to 420, we say that this is individual 3. Individual 3 is 25. Yeah. And then from here to 505, we have individual 4, because this is 80, and etc. Then what do we do? We generate a random number between 0 and this total fitness value. And if that random number falls into this region, we say that, okay, this individual is selected. If it falls into this region, then this individual is selected. And each individual has a selection probability which is directly proportional with its fitness value. Okay, so we can use such a selection scheme, or we can just use this mentioned selection. We select one parent based on fitness, the other one just randomly. Okay, and then we make a crossover. So a crossover operator, the classical crossover operator, works in this way. So we have this parent 1, and this is the solution, the chromosome of parent 1. And this is parent 2, which is the chromosome of parent 2. You see, the X1 value of parent 1 is this, X1 value of parent 2 is this. So these genes in parent 1 and parent 2 are different. Again, these genes are different. These genes are the same. These genes different. These genes are the same. Okay. So from these parent 1 and parent 2, basically, we select a cut point. Okay? We call it either cut point or a crossover point. So we cut this gene. Sometimes it is just the middle. Sometimes you randomly find the crossover point. You generate a random number between 1 and 7. And depending on that random number, you select this crossover point. If the random number is 6, for example, you divide it from here. Okay, so what do we do? Basically, it's very simple. We select the first part of parent 1. So from these parent 1 and parent 2, we will generate two offsprings, two childs, child 1 and child 2. And basically, we will take the first part of parent 1 and second part of parent 2 and combine these to obtain child 1. Okay? And then we will do the reverse. We will select the first part of parent 2 and second part of parent 1 to combine and obtain child 2. Okay, so this is a very simple and effective method of a crossover operation in genetic algorithms. But of course, it is not the only method. It is not the only way. This is just one way of performing. Now I want to show you another alternative for this crossover operator. As I said, these operators are limited with your imagination. The one that I just showed you is a very common type of crossover operator. Now I will show you another alternative. So again, from these two parents, parent 1 and parent 2, we will generate two offsprings. Okay, so again, in these offsprings, what do we have? We will have 7 genes to represent these 7 decision variables. So these are child 1 and child 2. In this method, basically what do you do? You compare the genes of parent 1 and parent 2. If they are identical, we place these genes to both offsprings. Okay? So these two are not the same. These two are the same. So we say that, okay, the third gene of child 1 and child 2 will be the same. The fourth gene, the fifth gene, yes, the fifth genes will also be the same. The sixth gene, seventh gene, they are different. Okay, so we have these genes, third and fifth genes, common in both offsprings. Then we need to fill in the other genes in child 1 and child 2, and in order to do it, basically we use random numbers. Okay, let me sketch one more time. So we said that this is 1 and this is 0 for child 1, and this is child 2, it is also 1 and 0. So for this one, okay, it can be either 1 or 0 coming from parent 1 or parent 2. And in order to understand from which it comes, we generate a random number between 0 and 1. If this random number is less than 0.5, then we use the gene of the first parent. Otherwise, we use the gene of the second parent. Okay? So, by this randomness, we fill in, let's say the first one comes from the first parent, the second one comes from the second parent, this one comes from second, and this one comes from second, and this one comes from first. You see, we fill in the gaps by using these random numbers. So for each one of these, we generate another random number. And also, we will use the same procedure to fill in the genes of the second child. Why did I write 3 here? It is 2. Okay, so this is another method of crossover operator. Both of them are used widely, and both of them try to keep the genes of parent 1 and parent 2 throughout this generation process. As I mentioned several times, in these meta-heuristic algorithms, in this genetic algorithm as well, we just have the main idea, but all the mechanism can be adapted, can be changed as you like. So the mechanisms, the operations that I am explaining here are to give you idea about how to implement these genetic algorithms. Okay? So usually what is done is, when you generate new offsprings, you can select an arbitrary individual in the population, or you can select the worst individual in the population and change it with the offsprings, okay? With the one of the offsprings. You can reproduce as long as you want, okay? So we said that from one generation to another in genetic algorithms, in one generation to another, some of the solutions will go directly. These are called allied solutions. Some solutions will go through an crossover operator, provide an offspring, and they will enter into the next generation. And some solution will have mutation and then enter into the next. And all these mechanisms can be changed. So you can adjust the allele percentage. Should it be 10% or should it be 50%? How you are making this crossover according to alternative 1 or alternative 2? And what will be the percentage of these crossovers? How do you select these individuals so that they are paired and they generate offsprings? When you generate two offsprings, how will you insert them? Do you directly insert them or do you first compare them with the existing individuals and according to their fitness are you inserting them? Or for these mutations may be applied directly to the individuals in the previous generation, or whenever you perform a crossover operation, you can apply the mutation to the individuals, and then after these mutations, you can insert them to the new generation. So there are many, many possibilities, and you can select any one of these possibilities. You can design on your own genetic algorithm with respect to these different design criteria. But usually, if you use these basic genetic algorithms with classical crossover and mutation, it usually works well. So according to the standard genetic algorithm procedure, what do we have? We have a fixed population size. We keep the population size the same. We perform a standard crossover in which one of the parents is selected according to fitness and the other one is selected randomly. Then we have a random crossover point. Then we make this crossing and we form individuals, and a random individual is exchanged with one of these offsprings. And in mutation, mutation, as I said, is a random change in individual genes of the solutions. So we have a certain probability for an individual. Okay, we will make examples. We have a random choice of which gene to mutate, and usually this mutation is applied to the offsprings. So you perform crossover, you generate new individuals, and then you apply a mutation to these individuals and send them to the new generation. But usually the mutation probability is a very small probability, but still you have to investigate which what percentage of probability is the best. So basically, as I said, mutation is an random change in one or some of the genes of the solutions. So if we have this solution representation 1010010, this is our let's say individual. In mutation, what happens if we want to apply a mutation to one of the genes? We may just complement its value. If it is 0, we can make it 1. If it is 1, we can make it 0. So this is a change in an individual gene, and it's a mutation. So what can we do? We can select one of these genes randomly. So we generate a random number between 1 and 7. And if this random number is 4, then we apply a mutation and complement its value so that we generate a new solution. Okay? By this mutation, we insert new genes into the solution space, which provides diversity of the solutions. Now we are ready to talk about the steps, the pseudocode of the genetic algorithms. Again, step 0 of this algorithm is the initialization. But this initialization is a little bit different than taboo search and simulated annealing, because in those we just need a single solution. But in genetic algorithms, we need to have a population of solutions. We need at least p solutions. And this is a little bit, this may be a little bit problematic for genetic algorithms, because you need a method to generate p individuals. Okay? And these individuals should be different from each other. So we need these initial starting feasible solutions. We need a stopping criteria, which is a which may be a number on the generation limit. Then we need a percentage of elite solutions, percentage of crossover operators, and sometimes we may have immigrations like mutations in genetic algorithms. Basically, immigration means this. Let's assume that you have this initial generation, and from this generation, by making crossover allied solutions and etc., so PE is the allied solutions, then with PC you make crossover and then insert this. And then what may happen is a percentage of new solutions can be inserted directly to here, and this percentage of solutions is found, let's say, by a construction algorithm or randomly. So these are immigrants, and again, these immigrant solutions satisfy diversity. Okay, it provides new solutions into this population. Okay, the stopping condition is if you reach Tmax generations, then we stop. And when you stop, the best solution in the current population is the solution provided by genetic algorithms, because from each generation to the next one, you are keeping the best solution. So you are never losing the best solution. You don't need to keep it in memory in a separate place. You just move the best solution to the next one, and when you stop, the best solution in that final generation is the best solution. Okay, so step two of the algorithm is the elite solutions. We said that from generation 2 to t to t plus 1, we copy the PE number or PE percentage of best solutions. Okay, so this is how we move the best solutions from one generation to another. In step 3, we either get some immigrant new solutions or we perform some mutations. So arbitrarily, we choose PI new immigrant feasible solutions or perform mutation operations to the existing ones and include them in the new generation. In step 4, the crossover operation, what do? In the current generation, we select these many number of non-overlapping pairs. Okay, so since these are pairs, we divide it by 2, and each pair will generate 2 offsprings, so that the total number of offsprings will be PC. Okay, so that here PE plus PI plus PC will be equal to your population size all the time. Okay, so then we execute a crossover operator. You can perform the classical operator or any other alternative, but the generated individuals will move to the next generation, and then we increment the generation index from t to t plus 1 and return back to step 1 until we reach the stopping criteria. Here we will make an example for TSP problem. Okay, we all know the TSP problem. Each city should be visited once, and we want to minimize the total distance. The first thing in genetic algorithm is the representation. Okay, and in this example, we decide to represent the cities in the order that we visit them. Okay, so let's assume that we have 8 cities and we want to travel through these cities. So the first solution can be 3 to 5, 5 to 7, 7 to 2, 1, 6, 4, and 8, and the second one can be this. The reason that we are making an example with TSP is because with this representation, the classical crossover operator is problematic. Why is that so? Remember, in classical crossover operator, what do? We select a crossover point or a cut point. So let's assume that this midpoint is the cut point. Then in order to represent, this is parent 1 and this is parent 2, in order to generate 2 childs, We take the first part of parent, so 3, 5, 7, 2, and combine it with the second part of the second parent, which is 8, 1, 3, 4. Okay? And do the same thing for the other child, 2, 5, 7, 6, 1, 6, 4, 8. Okay? But the problematic thing about this is, look at this solution carefully. Each city must be visited once. So look at this tree appears here and here. So we are visiting city 3 two times, and we are not visiting city 6. And similarly, in the second alternative, we are visiting city 6 two times, and we are not visiting city 3. So in fact, these solutions are not feasible. When I said that the selection of crossover method should be in combination with the encoding, that is what I was trying to say. Your solution encoding and your crossover operators should be appropriate, should be suitable to each other. So for this method of encoding for TSP, we need a different crossover operator. Let's see an alternative. Let's see an example. So the basic idea in crossover is to keep the individual properties of the parents in the child's. Okay? So as I said, for example, your color of your eye or hair comes from your parents, right? So the genes of your parents are maintained. And in this representation, what we need to maintain in the physical property, what is it? The physical property is, in fact, the distance between the cities. So, for example, if the parent is, let's say, 2, 5, 1, 3. If you put this 2 directly to the child, by itself, it is meaningless. For the child or for the physical property, the important thing is from which city am I going to which other, so that this distance, this choice is important. So not just keeping city, but keeping the order is important. Okay? So for this purpose, we can define a crossover operator like this. We select a region of the chromosome. Okay? So it can be a length of 4, a length of 3, so you can select this length. So if the length is selected as 4, what do? We select a segment of the crossover with 4 genes, and we move this directly to the child from the first parent. Then we have 4 empty genes, and we need to fill in these empty genes from parent 2. But how do? If we just directly copy this part to here, we will have 2 here and 2 here, and it will be infeasible. So we are not directly copying. What we are doing is, when we move this portion to the child, we look at for the other part, which cities are missing. So the missing cities, so 1, 6, 2, and 7 are already here. Missing cities are 3, 4, 5, and 8. Okay, so starting from this first empty position till to the last, we will place these missing cities in the order of appearance in the parent 2. So if you look at parent 2, 5 missing cities are 3, 4, 5, and 8. And you see 5 appears the first. So we place it to the first position. Then 8 appears, so we place it to the second, then 3, and then 4. So this is child 1. Okay, so now let's generate the child 2. Again, if we decide to keep this portion, then in this child 2, we will have 7, 6, 8, and 1 here. And then the missing cities are 2, 3, 4, and 5. So we will look at the first city, which one appears first? 3. Then 5. Okay, then which one appears? 2, 3. Then 2 appears. Okay, then 4 appears. Okay, so this is child 2. This portion, this part of the chromosome is maintained in child 2, and the other portion is filled with the order according to parent 1. Okay, so this is an alternative crossover that you can use with this encoding scheme, and it's important to understand this example and this crossover operator. And as I said, crossover operator is limited with your imagination. You can design your own crossover operator, but it shouldn't be just doing some operation. You need to think about what you are moving from one generation to another, what properties of the parents are transferred to the offsprings. That is the most important part in this crossover operators and designing these operators. Similar to the crossover operator, the mutation operator is also related with the solution encoding. Initially, we encoded the solution with a vector of binary variables. And when we want to make a mutation operator, we selected that we can select one of the genes randomly. And if it is 1, we complement it to 0. If it is 0, we complement it to 1. But in this representation for TSP, again, we cannot just complement it. So how can we perform a mutation operation? Basically, you can use the neighborhoods that we already taught about. You can use an insertion operator as a mutation operator, or you can use exchange, pairwise exchange operator as a mutation operator. So if you want to use exchange, for example, how do you do? If this is your solution and if you want to make a mutation, you randomly select 2 genes. Okay, you randomly select these. How do you do? Since there are 8 genes, you generate random number between 1 and 8 and generate another random number between 1 and 8. So this is random 1, A1, and this is A2. Okay, and you change the positions of these. So if A1 is here, you move it to the position of A2, and if A2 is here, you move it to the position of A1. And this is how you can perform a mutation operation using this. If you want to use insertion, what you can do, again, if this is your initial solution, you can generate a random number between 1 and 8. And let's say if this number is 5, you select the 5th gene. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, you select the 5th gene. And then you generate another random number between 1 and 8 again. And let's say that if this number is 2, you take this gene from its current position and insert it to the second position. I mean, you insert it here so that it becomes the second element in the position. So from here to here, we obtained a new solution. This may be another alternative for mutation operation. The most important distinctive property of genetic algorithms is you work with populations of solutions. You start with an initial population. From this one, you move to a new population. From this one, you move to a new population. And the size of the population is very important in the performance of genetic algorithms. If you use a smaller population, let's say if your population size is only 2, just 2 individuals, then you will not be able to search the whole solution space. Searching the solution space depends on the individual genes of these. Okay? If the initial solution, if these individuals in your initial solution does not cover the all possible solution alternatives, then in your solution space, if this is your solution space, you will be able to only search a certain region of the feasible solution space. And in order to diversify this, you need to maintain a larger population size. But when the population size is larger, it become computationally more demanding. So if you have, let's say, 1,000 solutions, 1,000 individuals in a population, then evaluating their fitness values, objective functions, selecting them for crossover operations, and making a new generation of 1,000 individuals, it will require many computations. Okay, so you should have a balance between the computational time and solution quality with respect to the population size. The optimal size increases exponentially with the string length in binary encodings. Okay, so if you have a solution for a problem with zeros and ones, then the size of the population, the optimal size of the population, can be very large, but usually a size of 30 can work in many cases, but you may have 10 to 100, but it all depends on the problem and the instance. So you should decide on the population. There is no strict rule. You can have a population of 10, you can have a population of 50. If you want better solutions, you can increase the population size. If you want to have solutions quickly, you can reduce the population size. Another important issue with genetic algorithm is, as we said, it starts or it continues with a population of solutions. Okay, we know from one generation to another how we will maintain the same population size. Some of the solutions will move directly. These are elite solutions. Some solutions will go through a crossover and then go to this one. And some solutions will have mutation. Maybe there will be some immigrations and etc. But the question is, how will we find these initial solutions? If we need, let's say, 100 individuals, how do we find 100 initial solutions? Usually, we find those solutions randomly. If you are using, for example, TSP, it's very easy to find 100 solutions or to find random solutions. Basically, you order the cities and different orderings will give you different solutions. But for some problems, finding initial solutions may be very difficult. You need a construction algorithm, and you need a construction algorithm that will provide different solutions at each run. And you will run this algorithm 100 times to generate you 100 different solutions. Okay? If you use such a construction algorithm to provide good initial solutions, you may obtain faster convergence, meaning that from one generation to another, one generation to another. So in two or three generations, you may find really good solutions. So we said that in genetic algorithms, usually we stop when we reach a certain number of generations. But still, you can use similar solution procedures or similar solution stopping conditions with tabu search and simulated annealing. So what can be a stopping condition? It can be, for example, number of generations, or it can be number of generations without an improvement. Without improvement. Or it can be time limit again. Okay? So with good initial solutions, if you are using, for example, this stopping criteria, you may stop very quickly because it will converge into three generations and you will stop maybe very quickly. So again, even the stopping condition is related with how you find your initial solution. Your crossover and mutation operations are related with how you encode your solutions. So you should think your design of genetic algorithm as a whole, not individual separate parts, but you need to think them as a whole. But on the other hand, if you input good solutions without randomness, then you may have premature convergence, because when you say good solutions, maybe all those good solutions are coming from one portion of the search space. So since there are no genes to represent the other portions of the search space, it will not diversify too much, and then it will converge to a solution over here, to a population of solutions over here, and it means that the diversification is not satisfied. Okay, again, even in genetic algorithms, intensification and diversification should be balanced. Diversification must be balanced, and you need to think of mechanisms of intensification and diversification. For example, if we have a higher mutation rate, does it work for intensification or diversification? The answer is diversification, right? For example, if we use immigrants, a large percentage of immigrants, will it work for intensification or diversification? So it will work for diversification, right? If we increase the, for example, the number of elite solutions from one generation to another, will it in favor of intensification or diversification? It is in intensification, right? So there should be a balance between this intensification and diversification. And usually in this finding initial population, we may have problems with feasibility, because for example, for the knapsack problem, if you just randomly form these 0-1 sequences, and when you check the constraint with this one, this may be infeasible. And what happens when there's an infeasible solution? You just ignore it and try to generate a new one. So in order to generate 100 feasible solutions, which are different from each other, you may need to generate maybe 500 solutions so that 400 of them are eliminated, since they are either infeasible or they are the same with previously generated solutions. So this may be the case. And also, in fact, when we are moving from one generation to another, when we make these crossover operations, for example, for the knapsack with the classical crossover operator, so we are cutting a portion of the chromosome and making this crossover. So for, let's say, child one, we have these and this, and the resulting child can be infeasible. Then what do you do? Then you may try to generate a new child by using a different pair of parents, or you may somehow change the cutting point, crossover point, or you may have a mechanism to convert an infeasible child to a feasible one. Okay, so these are some procedures that you need to think about the genetic algorithms. After these discussions, let's finalize our lecture on genetic algorithms by considering several issues for practitioners. So if you want to develop a genetic algorithm, if you want to implement a genetic algorithm for a problem, then you need to decide on these issues, and not limited to these ones, but these are the most important ones. You need to decide on solution representation, which we call encoding. You need to decide on the population size, mutation rate. You need to decide on the selection from one generation to another, or deletion policies. You need to decide on crossover and mutation operators. There are alternative operators, and there are alternative methods to select the individuals to become parents. You need to think about the termination criteria, whether a time limit or an iteration or generation limit. Okay? You need to consider the performance and the scalability. What do I mean? If you want higher performance, then you need larger population size and longer running times. But when the problem instance is larger, higher population size and larger generations will end up with longer solution times. So the solution will take time, and the same trade-off with tabu search and simulated annealing is here also. If you want high quality solutions, then you will sacrifice from your solution time. Okay, so these are the most important issues related to genetic algorithms, and this is the end of our discussion on genetic algorithms.